الله الرحمن الرحيم. أول شيء أحب إني أشكركم فرداً على تواجدكم اليوم معنا هني. وجودكم يعني لنا الكثير ودعمكم للمؤسسة ومساندتكم لا أثر كبير ودافع كبير لنا كمؤسسة، ولو أن إحنا مؤسسة جديدة، لكن مساندتكم المستمرة لنا لها معنى كبير بالنسبة لنا، فمشكورين على تواجدكم اليوم معنا. أما كون أن ضيوفنا من دول مختلفة من حول العالم، أحب أني أستأذنكم أن هذه الجلسة تكون باللغة الإنجليزية حتى نقدر أن هم يفهمون علينا وإحنا نفهم عليهم. فبعد إذنكم I'd like to start this panel discussion session by communicating in English so that everyone can understand, given that our international guests are from various places around the world. First of all, I'd like to thank the various groups that have attended, the organizations, the charities, the institutions that have taken place and that have attended today and participated. I'd like to give you a short introduction about today's event. A few weeks ago, I was approached by my brother Ali Larefi when we started planning out this event and inviting these three influential personalities to Bahrain. And he told me that we should organize something that can leave a touch with the people. And that was the birth of Success Stories. Success Stories is the first of a series of events that we're going to be having over the coming months and over the coming years. We want to shed light on the most influential personalities around the world, bring them to Bahrain, and make sure their stories are heard in our community. I'd like to start by introducing our first panelist, Chau-Giang Thi Nguyen. Chau-Giang is a world-renowned musician. She has performed in countless concert halls around the world, most prominently a sold-out concert in Carnegie Hall. She is also an outstanding artist, and she has exhibited her art in the most prestigious venues around the world, most prominently the Oceanographic Museum in Monaco. Next to her is renowned businesswoman Maribel Lieberman. Maribel is a skilled chef and a trained designer. She has brought the two together and managed to create one of the most unique and creative businesses in New York, Maribel. I shouldn't be saying too much. I should let her tell her story because no one can tell it better than her. Last but absolutely not least is Selima Salaun. Selima is the person behind Selima Optique. She is originally from North Africa, and she is the founder of Selima Optique, which is the famous sunglasses and eyeglasses company. Selima also serves on the board of the Council of Fashion Designers of America, the CFDA. Those of you that follow fashion, you know that the CFDA awards were held just a few weeks ago.
Yes.
So Selima serves on the board of that organization. So without further ado, I'd like to start our first discussion session with Chau-Giang. Chau-Giang Thi Nguyen, your name in Vietnamese means River of Diamonds, which is one of the most beautiful names I have heard. But all of us here and all your friends refer to you as Coco, so I'd like to ask your permission if I can refer to you as Coco here today. So Coco, the best place to start a story is right at the beginning. So I'd like to start the same way with you. Can you tell us more about your childhood and early life and how you have come to discover your talent?
Well, I was born...
Yeah.
Hello. I was born in Hanoi right around the time when the war was ending. And I would say like a dust of war, you know, dust of war, and we went through. It was a difficult time for everybody because before that we have the French war and the land reform in Vietnam, then the American war. So my grandparents was fine before the French war. My grandmother had quite a good life, but after the war, everybody became very poor, and we went through that. And now, if thinking back, it was like a gift because, you know, we start from very bottom, so everything else after that is a plus. And it was difficult, but it was lucky enough for all of us to have free education from the government. So at the age of 6, I went to regular school. Then at 11, we were accepted to Hanoi School of Music and Fine Art. And with all the free education, I was able to study piano. And you talk about talent. I wasn't sure that I have any talent at all, but just but the first day I went to school and I was chosen to be the president of class, of every class in school. I don't know why, maybe it was just a little taller than other friends. And then my father has a great love of classical music. He was telling me that during the war, he would go to the little building in Bading district and stay under the window of a building to listen to classical guitar. And he also played classical guitar, loves music. So I was thinking that maybe he used me to continue his dream. But then I remember telling my friend that before I went to school at age 6, I was doing like this on the bed, the head, board of the bed, and my father said, I think that's the sign that maybe she wants to play the piano. It must be that I was watching TV, so I didn't remember that, but my friend told me that. But in the beginning, it was I never liked music in the beginning. Half hour practicing was really long. So I remember just sitting at the piano and crying. Not practicing until later on, and when we start performing in school, you know, put on the dresses and makeup, and I start enjoying and start, you know.
You got accepted to Juilliard and learned from the best of the best. What did that mean to you, having the background and childhood that you had?
I felt that, you know, compared to other friends, I was very fortunate to be able to come to New York, and that school just gives you like a battlefield that you have to be a very good soldier. It's very competitive to be in school. You'd be able to meet a lot of international students from all over the world, and they're very good. So it make you feel like you have to work very hard to just get along, and you know, if you want to be something good, you have to work very hard.
Yeah. You worked at one point with the renowned composer Hans Zimmer, and who is one of the greatest composers alive. Can you tell us more about that?
Well, Hans Zimmer is a friend, and he invited me to his studio many times, and he introduced me to all his composer in the studio, and he also wanted to me to work with musician like Joe Chabel and Lauren Buffett. So being in his studio and see all the studios, all the musicians, you learn something about the composition in film. So it's very inspired to think about writing for pictures And so after that, I met with Arturo Sandoval, the trumpet player, and we were invited to write music for Debbie Allen ballet, Hot Chocolate Nutcracker.
So, beautiful.
Yeah. You lived in Los Angeles at one point in your life, and upon your return to New York, you debuted your performances in New York at Carnegie Hall for a sold-out performance, which is probably one of the biggest honors any artist can ever receive. What are your reflections of that day?
It felt very, you know, you have to be responsible for it now, because you basically present the Vietnamese musician in New York, and the same week, some teachers and professors said that, you know, you'd probably be the first one to perform there. So you feel a little kind of pressure, but it's also the excitement. And you question yourself, like, is really people coming to hear you play? And it feel like, I feel I have done my duty to my father, you know, for all his love and hard work that he sacrificed for me. So this is my answer for my dad and for my grandmother and all my teacher and professor in school that I owe the love for, and so it felt very special. Yeah.
There is no doubt that what you have achieved in the past reflects the essence of success, and we applaud you on that. So what I would like to end this session with you is by asking you, what is your definition of success?
I never thought about a success for anything. I feel like I'm so busy to just keep walking in front, ahead. And for musicians, for artists, we always, searching for new places. I'm not sure it exists. You're very busy to just working and discover. But one of the definitions of success is, I guess, that you can achieve I think successful is being having a lot of people love you and cherish you, and being successful, you know, is what you that you can give your that you can benefit people. If you can benefit and make an impact, important impact for the people behind you, or inspire people with a big amount, as many as possible, I think is measurement of your success. And
that's a very good answer.
Thank you for that.
Yeah. Thank you for that. I'd like to open the floor for any questions from the audience to Ms. Chau-Giang. Do we have a microphone over here? Microphone's coming. So that everyone can hear the question. Could you please introduce yourself?
Hi, my name is Fatma Khalifa, and I wanted to ask you, what do you feel when you play?
When I play?
Yes, when you play.
It's a way of... you know, the classical music is very, very special in the way that I feel it speak to people in a very noble way. Classical music is like composer like Bach, especially Bach, is like principle of living. It has a special language that it touched me that I feel that. That I feel this is the way you describe your feeling in the deepest level, more than words, to say a sentence or your feeling. So it's your duty that you have to, mission that you have to transfer that to the audience. And music represent a lot of emotions, so everything, happiness, sadness, even regret, it's very important ingredients for writing or playing. You know, when you're playing, you would feel that regretness of the composer that transcribed into the piece of music. So it's exciting to be able to describe that, you know, through your fingers, and the finger basically, you know, go through your body, and so it's love, it's love. Yes.
Any other question?
Hi, yes. I just wanted to say first, my name is Cuckoo also. you said at the age of 6, yes, you never liked music.
Yes.
And how do you feel now?
Well, I like it. I like, but in the beginning, like everything else, it's hard. And you have, and the teacher will give you like the homework. We do twice a week lesson. And sometimes the teacher, when they're very disciplined and strict, then I feel this is not fun, you know? Yeah, but then, yeah, I did not like it because in the beginning, if the teacher always say like, you know, something is wrong with your finger, the technique has to do this, you have to play it with round finger like this, and
so you learned it.
Yeah,
but you didn't born with that feeling of
yeah,
being.
Yeah, I think the talent, you know, is only take about 40% for success, because the rest is hard work. Doesn't matter if you're born with talent, unless you are like Kisi or Lang Lang, you know. All of us have to work very hard.
Perfect.
Yeah, it's mainly the hard work, unless you're born genius, but most of us, you know, yeah.
Other questions?
Hi, good evening. Hi. My name is Hamad Al Khalifa. I wanted to ask you a question. There are many composers. Is there someone that you look up to or admire?
Yes, I admire from everybody, actually. Like from Bach, Bach is the technique is chasing each other, like the few chasing.
Yeah.
So it can be one melody, and then you can repeat in a different interval, like third or sixth or fourth, and it's chasing each other, and that's why I create a few. So if you don't want to write a song, a pieces into a different kind of technique, you can always sit down with a piece of paper and write Bach, a technique's Bach, and chasing each other. So basically it's like math.
Yeah.
Yeah. And but like Beethoven, Mozart and Beethoven, all the German composer, also very exciting. Schubert is very poetic, and Beethoven, because he was writing music during the war, so it represent, I think it represent a lot of German soldier, you know, and. So it's very, yeah.
Thank you. Other questions?
I think your story is fascinating.
Thank you.
But I'm wondering, you spoke about your childhood and how the childhood experience was tainted by war.
Mm.
And arguably your childhood and the childhood of so many other Vietnamese was shaped by, and really the fate of Vietnam was in the balance, shaped by the interventions of foreign powers, mostly European and powers and the states as well.
Mm.
But you chose to embrace rather than reject something, classical music, that is essentially a European tradition.
Yes, because
As opposed to reject it. And I'm fascinated by that fact. So was classical music to you, did you see it as an international neutral medium of expression as opposed to the language of your occupiers or the foreign powers or whatnot?
Mm.
I don't know, maybe you don't talk about Chopin that much, so maybe you don't like
French
as much. But
I do play Chopin. Well, because the influence from the French colonial was in Vietnam for over 100 years. And when I grew up, the school system is very French influenced. And even the people, you know, the way they walk and talk, that's why you would see the Vietnamese a little bit different than other Asian countries. It has more... A little bit gracious, I would say, you know. I feel that, and everybody in Hanoi and Saigon, they really care about poems and paintings, and everybody is very serious about, you know, about music, and I pick up from that. So we do have traditional music in school, but I didn't study the traditional music. So our the classical department is completely on the other side of the building. So I grew up with that. Yes.
Thank you. One final question.
My name is Ahmed. Do you think that classical music was taken over by modern music, or is the classical music only listened by special people that has a good taste of music? Thank you.
That's a good question. You want to answer that? I think the influence of European, you know, and the French, I think it depends on each person, the responsible, you know, respond for the style of the music, but it's also we have a lot of Russian influence, because at the time the Vietnamese government sent a lot of Russian the people to study in Russia, so in Russia the classical music is very serious. So with those people and the people that already influenced by the French and they love the classical music for the way for what it is, I think we have good, very good amount of people that really love classical music in Vietnam.
Yes. Thank you very much, Coco. Thank you for this session. So now I'm going to move on to Ms. Maribel Lieberman. First of all, I'd like to start the same way that I started with Coco, by asking you about your early life. You were born and raised in Honduras, in Central America, and in the cocoa fields. Did you have any sort of indication that this would be part of your future career?
Well, hi. I'm so happy to be here, and I love to participate in this type of panels because my story is very common to any entrepreneur, passionate. But I like to tell it because I like to inspire people. If my story inspires them, and I feel like I'm doing something, giving back. Answering your question, I grew up in Honduras. Did I have any clue that I would be involved in cacao? No. I grew up drinking hot chocolate, but we call it hot cocoa. Hot cacao. It was not hot chocolate. So we were roasting the bean and grinding it and making a drink with water, and that was part of like a coffee. So, but I was an entrepreneur since I was a little girl. I was making caramels and selling them in school. At the age of 8. And at the age of 9, I bought my first pair of shoes. So I was very proud of that. So that I would get involved in the food industry, I didn't think about it. My mother was a seamstress, and she was the seamstress for all the people in the village where we lived. And I always thought I would become a fashion designer. And I always thought I would travel very far away. So I never saw myself in that village, you know, when I grew up. So at the age of 17, when I went to high school, we moved to the city because I come from a very big family. We are 8 kids. I am the youngest one. And a little bit more like, they used to call me the black sheep of the family. Why? Because I always thought out of the box. When it came time to go to school, to go to high school, we had two choices, either to go to a career like get just regular high school to go to college, or to get another career and then like you could work after that, and then and then go to the university. So I wanted to study architecture. And my mother saw that I was too hyper to do things, and she decided that I should study bilingual secretary, so I could work. If I drop out of school, I could have something to work. So she put me through it. I went alone, you know, I mean, I was young, I was 16, and when the second year in secretarial school, I flunked two classes and I couldn't continue. And I was very sad because most of my sisters and brothers were graduating with medals, and I was just emphasizing that I was the black sheep of the family. So it was very depressive. I mean, I was very young, and at the age of 17, I decided that it was time to move on. And I was very young. I mean, I couldn't think of my daughter saying, "I'm moving. I'm going away," you know, because. But I did, and with the help of a friend of mine, I went to United States to study English, and I studied there for 1 year, and then I started going to fashion school at nighttime and working daytime, and that's how I became a fashion designer. I arrived in New York. That's how my career started, and yeah. You know. I don't want to tell my whole story because you have a lot of questions.
well, my next question to you is, as I mentioned earlier, you're a chef and a designer.
Yes.
So we would all like to know how you managed to draw the link between the two and come up with something extremely creative.
Well, you know, I went to fashion school. I love fashion. But once in the fashion industry, I understood that I was not really happy in that world of fashion. I felt it was not for me. Although I love to create, but it wasn't for me. So that's when I started discovering that I love food. And living in New York, it exposed me to a lot of different type of food, many cultures, and I love that. And so that's how I started buying a lot of cookbooks, and that's how I trained myself to be a chef. Sorry? Yeah, but we can bring it after. Okay.
When we get to Maribel, then we can bring out the chocolates.
Okay. Oh, yeah. Pass them around. Yeah. Okay. Okay. I forgot that I brought you chocolates. Okay.
Maribel said in the beginning that she likes taking part in panel discussions. I should mention that in the past, Maribel took part in a discussion session alongside Hillary Clinton and Oprah Winfrey. So this is really an honor to have you with us here today, since you've been in such esteemed situations in the past. You're an all-rounded artist. You're a visual artist, a fashion designer, and a culinary artist. What is your observation on art, talent, and creativity as a career path in life?
I have actually feel very fortunate because I discover what I really like. Mm-hmm. You know, when you're growing up, you think you're gonna do this and you're gonna do that, and you go a long life and then you start discovering what you really like. And I was fortunate, why? Because I got into fashion, which I thought I always want to be a fashion designer. Then I started discovering about food, but it was not so much about food eating that I love. It was about getting to know the cultures. Because I was exposed in so many cultures in New York, I would go into every different neighborhoods and just, you know, go in for a whole day, buy all the spices, even if I didn't know what spices, what was it for, and then I started buying cookbooks to use, you know, from that culture, and then I started using those ingredients, and that's how I became an international chef.
Earlier today, me and you were talking, and I mentioned to you that many of the younger generation in Bahrain, they usually start at home. They usually start their businesses at home, and I'm sure everyone can back me up that we have a big cupcake industry in Bahrain, and many of the young girls, they like starting at home. And you surprised me by telling me that you started
at home. You know what happened? In the beginning, when I saw that I love cooking, I thought that I would probably would like to maybe open a business in food, but I didn't like the fact that just it was about opening a restaurant and doing the same food. What I really, really loved was creating different things for different events, like catering. So I opened a catering company, and I started from home, and that's how I started cooking from home. And 5 years later, that's when I moved on to open my chocolate business.
Yeah. Well, just to mention, since we are on the topic of this, there's a huge delegation from the Bahrain Society for Business Women who is here today to greet you. There, all of them are over here.
Okay, all right. Okay.
From this point, we go into the subject of the creative economy, which is actually the main purpose behind this event. I can see Maribel's chocolates are distracting the audience over here. They're very much into your chocolates. The creative economy propels the economic and social development in any economy. And here in Bahrain, it's a growing industry.
Okay.
So what we'd like to hear from you is what words do you have to share that can inspire the rising generation in regards to following their dreams?
I think in any economy, I think we have to start with ourselves, finding out who you are and what you really like. And unfortunately, not many people get to see that of themselves until they get older. Sometimes they find themselves it's already too late. It's good to find out at an early age what you really like, and it does not matter what you love. You're gonna succeed, you know, on what you really love, because being passionate and persevere is what is gonna lead you to success.
Perfect. Just yesterday we were talking that we both managed to find a career path in doing the thing we really love. Speaking about myself for 2 seconds, I have managed to find my career in Visionaries, and by doing something that is actually important to me and something that I'm passionate about. I mean, I inherited my devotion to the nonprofit and civil society sector from my mother, Sheikh Al Amin Abd Muhammad, who's actually here today with us, the president of Al Nur Charity Welfare. But it evolved into something that's really special to me, and it allowed me to grow. So we had that in common when we were talking about that topic.
That's great to find that.
Yeah. So coming to your business now, Maribel, and so how many rows have tried the chocolate so far? This section have tried it already. I should mention that the box that's going around, the chocolates, the artwork that's printed on...
No, that's not her. It's the other one.
There's actually a special collection with Coco's paintings that have been made on the artwork. But every single piece of chocolate has a work of art on it, which means that every single piece of chocolate is a work of art, given that it's been made by...
You know, that's what I was saying, that it takes passion, you know, and it's not only about eating a piece of chocolate. I feel that visual, you know, like the art is very important as when you taste. So in my collection of chocolate, it's like there is an influence of fashion design, mm-hmm. or my daily life, and each of the images also represent what I'm thinking. I write a little poem, what my inspiration is. And so people, before eating it, they stop, look at it, appreciate it, and eat it. And I think it's the healthiest way to eat.
If you're, are you saying that chocolate is healthy?
Of course, I'm a pharmacist.
Maribel, your store, sorry? Yes, it's alcohol free.
Yeah,
of course. All right, we can proceed. Your business, Maribel, has multiple stores located in various locations around the world. Could you tell us what motivated you to open stores in these specific places that you have chose to open
your
stores?
Well, like I said before, what inspired me was the cultures of the different parts of the world. And so going abroad, you know, to open stores is just an extension of my inspiration. I really like to I want my chocolates to be embraced by every culture and feel familiar with it. Like when you find chocolate with saffron, you're gonna feel, oh, this is an ingredient I know. Because I want people to be part of my collection.
So you have... So you, yeah. So you have one store in New York.
I have one store in New York. I'm opening another one also in New York, and we also open in Japan, four stores. We open two in Tokyo and two in Kyoto, and they're doing very successful. Very successful.
Perfect. other than being an outstanding businesswoman that you are also a humanitarian.
Yes.
Recently, you have gone back to your home country, Honduras.
Yes.
And you have opened a cocoa production farm for your chocolates over there.
Yes.
What was your inspiration for that?
Well, actually, I'm very lucky that I grew up with cacao, and the raw material of my success is in my country. So I feel that... I became very known in Honduras, and all the, you know, I'm not a cacao processor, I'm a chocolate manufacturer. So I decided to open a manufacturer of cacao and convert it into chocolate and buy directly from the farmer and pay them a more fair price and have a relationship with the farmer. Because a lot of times the farmers doesn't really get to see their product, and there is not enthusiasm there. They're just trying to sell what they grow. And I think one of the ways that I want to do is also show them the final product of what they're growing. And I think that creates enthusiasm. And then because agriculture is actually how we all survive.
Yeah. And only an intelligent woman can understand that and make it happen. the same way that I ended with Coco, I'd like to end with you. What is your definition of success?
I think success is about being, I mean, doing what you love, about doing giving what you have done, if you can give. About living with integrity in life, about helping others, and about feeling happy of your life, of what you've done.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Maribel. again, I'd like to open the floor for any questions from the audience. Okay, let's start over here.
So, my name is Nawaf Al-Kahiji. My question is, what kind of support did you get to open your business?
Well,
No, because here in Bahrain, we have a lot of support from the government, from the banks, from the industry itself. So, I'm thinking of maybe New York or your Honduras. No, it's tough?
No, it's very tough. I was able to, before I opened my chocolate business, I wanted to open a store before I did my my chocolate. I did my catering for 5 years, and the reason I started the catering is because what I wanted to do is, my dream was, it's called Epicerie, which is represent every country's ingredients, and you know, and even put a flag of every country what ingredients are famous for, because I think it's time for all the cultures to know each other, and you know, and food is a great medium to get peace, you know, this is what I love. So I didn't have the money for that. Okay, it was very expensive. So So then I said, okay, I'm going to start with catering, save up some money. I was able to save $50,000 at the end of 5 years. And with that, and I borrow another $50,000 from the bank, and I opened my store.
Any other questions over here?
Were you not intimidated with other chocolatiers like Godiva and Lindt?
You know, I mean, most of the time when you open a business, you go and research and who's your competition. But when you don't have much resources, you don't go and find a because you're going to get intimidated. So I didn't do that.
Do we have the microphone? We have several questions over here.
Leila Al-Mulla, they always saying that successful people are writing their goals. Are you one of them?
They said
always the successful people, successful persons are writing their goals in front of them.
Well, entrepreneur, it's you're always going to be an entrepreneur and you're never going to be satisfied with what you've done. For me, I'm still going, you know, and probably when I'm 90, if I get to be there at that age, I'm still going to be going. So I feel, do I feel success? I feel that I have achieved some goals, but I have more goals to achieve. You always put in, tracing new goals.
Do you write them?
Yeah, I do write goals. Yeah, I do.
Okay, thank you.
There's a question in the back.
Hello, my name is Mariam.
Hi.
I have great admiration for all three of you ladies. And thanks for coming and speaking to us and sharing your experience. You said that your family considered you the black sheep. So being the black sheep, you know, and you've made so many wonderful achievements. So I was wondering if you were the white sheep, what your achievements would be.
I work very hard for that.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes.
So what kept you motivated to go on and on? Continue.
I always had a vision. Always had a vision, and this is what my parents never saw. My family were more conservative. They went to very serious careers, like nutritionists, lawyers. You know, more traditional. I never wanted to be either a lawyer or a doctor. I don't know what I wanted to be, but I know I didn't want to be in Honduras, and I just see my vision around the world. So I had no idea what I was gonna do. Only knew that I wanted to be a fashion designer, then discover all these things. But I feel that today, you know, my family sees me like somebody very successful. I also employ some of my brothers and sisters. So yes.
We have one more question over here. Sheikh Abu Kamal, is there a microphone?
I think Maribel by now knows me well and the other guests, but for all of you who don't know me, I'm Sheikh Abu Kamal, the Vice President of Visionaries. So Maribel, now that you're accomplished and you've been nicknamed, your chocolates have been nicknamed as the Cartier of Chocolate, do you personally consider yourself the best chocolatier worldwide, or have you encountered anyone that you consider better? Like in terms of your standards?
I admire good chef, I admire good product. And I whenever I travel, and I like to travel, one of the reasons I like to travel is to do some more research. And I admire good products. Sometimes I have found better than me, and then I work to be just as good or better.
Thank you.
I had one question one time by somebody in New York, a French actually, an owner of a big company that I'm not going to say, but it's in the confectionery industry. And then he said to me, "Oh, you have very good chocolates. What school did you go to?" And I said, "I didn't go to any school, but I come from the land of cacao."
Hello, good evening. Thank you for coming. It has been a pleasure. Dr. Lulu Al-Mutlaq, being a woman, what do you see the challenges that you have faced in the business world? I know you are in America, but it's not different than any Arab world. As a woman, you face some challenges. This is the first question. The second question is, what are your advices for the businesswoman in the years ahead? Because most of us are already in business and we have been doing, but your advices, please. Thank you.
Number one, the challenges of, especially being from Honduras, I'm a foreigner from Honduras, very short, you know. There were some with an accent speaking English, and I never saw myself oh my God, they're gonna. One of the biggest enemies for us is feeling intimidated, and so I always work myself not to feel intimidated by anybody. I mean, it can be. I think we all are human beings. Some people have achieved a lot more than me, and many people. But I think if we all working in a straight line and hard, it does not matter. Nothing is, because we are born with a lot of good things. You know, we are born with a great brain. You know, health. If we're healthy, we have everything to succeed. And it's about working hard. And don't feel like, you know, there's going to be people, not only, you know, all kinds of people are gonna try to stop you, and you can't listen to that. You have to be very secure what you're doing, and, you know, just forget about it. You know, just like you say, forget about the negative and just think about the positive. And your other question was? Well, it's the same. I think we all have to believe in ourselves, number one, you know. And number two is that don't let anybody stop you, you know. You just have to really trust yourself. Okay.
Thank you very much.
Hello, good evening. After tasting your chocolate and, of course, knowing you so well now personally, we would like to know when your chocolates will be available in Bahrain.
Well, it's all up to you. You can bring them.
Will Amazon do it?
Amazon, I don't think I would give it to Amazon. Because it's very perishable. My chocolates are very natural, and the shelf life is very short. And the only way to do it is like what I did in Japan, to open store because we need to take care of it. It can't just go and put it, merchandise it anywhere.
Thank you.
Yeah, I have a question for myself.
Yes.
Yeah, as a chocolate lover for myself, I would like to ask you, what do you want to say for people who want to reach a healthy point for their lives?
Well, I think...
Because chocolate makes me really unstable.
No, but do you think a chocolate is not healthy?
I read that chocolate is really healthy for your heart.
Yeah, exactly.
Because it makes you happy.
Exactly. It's everything. You know, it's everything. It's not only makes you happy, but it's very healthy. And this is one thing that in the past, a lot of companies were introducing chocolate, very not so expensive, but actually now that I came into the business and found out how chocolate is made, it's about all the ingredients that they put in it. Sometimes a bar of chocolate is not really chocolate, it's flavor of chocolate, and they put palm oil, you know, and so there are a lot of many bad ingredients sometimes they do in a cheap bar of chocolate, and this is very unhealthy. So The best chocolate that you can have for healthiness is actually dark chocolate from 70 and up, you know.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Zeta Adros. I'm the board treasurer of Visionaries. First of all, I'm very, very impressed with your story. All three of you, but especially Maribel, because I'm a huge chocolate lover and I always minimize the intake of appetizers and main course in restaurants just to jump to the desserts. First of all, every person when he eats chocolates He has a certain feeling and the description of this chocolate that he eats. Yes. So I was going a while back on your the book that has the chocolates in them and a description. Mm-hmm. So my question is, while you are combining the ingredients of the chocolate, do you think of the description of it or after you eat it, while you write them?
The description comes from the design.
Okay.
Okay? I create the design first. And then I start thinking, what flavor I'm going to use this design, you know, and that's, I start relating the design with certain type of ingredients, like sometimes, let's say, matcha tea, it's a Japanese tea. There is a design that's it's a woman doing yoga. So, you know, that I create the design first, and then that I write the poem after the design, and then I do the recipe for the chocolate.
Thank you. We have another question in the back, and then one in the front.
Hello, Maribel.
Hi.
How are you? Okay, maybe she knows me, but the others. My name is Mohammed Abdelilah. I have a small question. Will you gonna be inspired by Bahraini culture for like upcoming collection?
Well, as that's what I was saying before, that all the cultures inspire me. And I mean, finding some of the sweets here that I have already tasted, I found that not only the sweets, but the design, I know what I'm going to do next.
Thank you. We have a question in the front.
Sorry, I just have I'm just curious, being a visitor of Japan and seeing what they have around in the market. Have you ever reached a point in your career where you look at the other competitors that are creating chocolates of a certain caliber, like of a certain standard, and you say, okay, that's not where I want to go?
Yes. Like,
yes.
Yes, I have.
So you stopped and you said, okay, I don't want to get there. I want to move this way instead.
Okay. Let's say there are certain brands that are, you know, consider good brands, but I always go for my taste. You know, at the end, it's my taste that I'm selling. You know, I could bring some of the ingredients or taste that like a Japanese taste, but it has to go through my palate at the end.
Okay,
thank you very much. Thank you, Maribel.
Okay.
It's going
to be hard to speak about that.
moving on to Selima Salaun. You have a unique advantage today. That will ease this session after talking about chocolate for so long. You are a proud Arab woman.
Yes.
Ahlan
wa sahlan.
You are originally North African. You are half Algerian, half Tunisian. And you went on to study in France.
Mm-hmm.
Could you tell us more about your early life?
Okay. First of all, I would like to thank you, Khalifa, for giving us the opportunity to present our stories here in your amazing country. It's my first time in Bahrain, and we've been, the three of us, completely impressed and happy. Thank you. Yeah, I was born in Tunis, and actually, I wanted to be a vet, but my mom is a very, very strong woman, and she was one of the first entrepreneurs that I really admired in my life. And she was at a dinner party in Algeria, and she hears people saying, I'm buying the lenses for my glasses. I mean, the optical shop, so optical shop owner saying, I'm buying lenses in France, shipping them. The client has to wait like 2 weeks or a month, I forgot. And she was like, no, I have to open a factory here. And then she opened this eyewear factory, and she's like, you're not going to vet school, you're going to go to optical school. And I was really not happy about it, but I had no choice. You couldn't say no to the parents. Mm. You know how it is to be an Arab daughter. Then I went to optical school in the middle of the mountains near Geneva, and I was so bored. I was like, oh my God, I hate this life. It was, you know, really dark and everything. I was coming from a sunny place, and I was like, okay, I have no choice, I have to do it. And after 2 years, I decided, okay, you know what, if I have no choice, I'm going to do this, I have to do it the best way I can. And I went to optometry school in Paris, and I started working for, at the same time, for the best optical shop in Paris that was catering to the, it was called Royal Optique, and it was catering to all the kings of this world. It was amazing, in the 16th district. Then here I was, a very young girl, working during the day, and then going in the evening in school, and going the weekend, and I learned to work like 7 days a week, and no vacation, nothing. And I had like, it's not a dream at the time, I was like, I have to be the best, because I really, really wanted to impress my parents. And then, I, after working for Royal Optique, I was another French company called Alain Miquelet, that was the best optical company at the time in the world, hired me because they heard about, I could do everything. I was doing eye exams, I was cutting the lenses, I was choosing the frames, and I was working like I could custom make frames, but I didn't think about doing my own brand. But Alain Miquelet said to me, I want to hire you as an optician ambassador and open all the stores for me. And then I called my mom and said, you know, I'm really sorry, I'm not coming back to Algeria or Tunisia. I'm going to open stores all over the world. And I was working then for Alain Miquelet. And then I started saving money, because I have a feeling you will ask me, how could you open your own business later? I started saving money because I was like, I want to do open a company, do eyewear, but make it chic, make it unbelievably like fashionable. Because at the time, eyewear was very conservative. And I was like, I want to make the best, I want to make a brand, I want to be worldwide famous. I had a dream, that's when the dream came up. And I started traveling for Miquelet in France, and then I went to New York City. And the funny thing about New York is I was never attracted by America. But my mother, years before, had won a scholarship to go to Columbia School, Columbia University. That was the first Arab woman winning that scholarship, because she had won a contest, you know, like for French, all the French colonies had like an exam, and she was the number one prize. Then I was really admirative of her, and she was supposed to go to Columbia, and she never made it because her father passed away like a month before she left. And it was like her dream was crushed, and here I was, fulfilling in a strange way my mother's dream to go to America and start working there. Then I went to New York for Alain Miquelet, and I was working for him, and I fell in love with the city, because that city is like so full of energy, and you can see like women from different worlds. I didn't speak English very well because I grew up speaking French, and I was like you know, a foreigner, but you feel like you can achieve anything. It's true, no? Yes. Yeah, and I was like, oh my God, this city is amazing, you know? And I would, what? Yeah, you arrive in New York and you're like, oh my God, I can make it. I'm opening a store or 10 stores or 100. So, you know, you go like, you have, the dream is huge. It's amazing. Look, we have a black president. I mean, it's amazing, you know. And what happened is I was working for Miquelet and I was saving money. And I decided to open my first store in an artistic area in Manhattan that I adore. It's called Soho. And immediately it was, you know, it was like either I was going to open and be successful, or I would have to go out of business and go back home in Algeria, because I had no money. I had just saved enough to, and at the time for you it was 100, but for me it was like $40,000. And I opened the store the first day. It was a huge success. And I was, since then, it's been now 20 years. And at the time when I opened, I was carrying different brands, and I decided to, a client walked in and said, I want something special. And he looked around, he said, I don't find anything I like here. He said, I want something really special. And I said, okay, it was a man. I said, I'm going to do like this big, thick, round, red glasses that look like Le Corbusier, but in red. And I said, I want to do this for you. He said, okay. And since then, he wears them until now. It's amazing. I mean, he changed a few pairs, but he has always the thick, round glasses. And that's how it started.
I was just thinking about this on the drive here from the hotel, because just before you left, you told me that you are an optician and a doctor.
Optometrist.
So I was wondering if we should refer to you as Dr. Selima.
Absolutely.
Okay.
No.
I think this is the only place in the world that's going to ask you this question, so it's my honor to be asking you this. How has your culture and heritage, being an Arab woman, influenced your work and creativity as an artist and a designer?
Yeah, what happened is I was born by the Mediterranean Sea, that's what I always say. Born in Tunisia, living in Algeria, it's very sunny, it's very bright, it's very colorful. I was going to the souk, you know, on the weekends and wearing all this, you know, jellabas. I mean, you know, she saw me. I go at light at events, I wear a jellaba like navy blue with gold. And, you know, I love the richness and the cultural heritage we have. And Algeria has been invaded, you know, by... You know, we had the Ottoman Empire, we had the Roman. Then it's like a very, very, very rich country. Mm-hmm. And in my eyewear, what it makes it very special, and everybody refers to it, it's like extremely colorful. And they say, why? I say, colors make you happy. And, you know, living by the sea, having a strong sun, I think makes you very positive about life.
Similar to Maribel, you also have several stores around the world. Mm-hmm. What motivated you to expand to an international scale?
Yeah, you know, again, being in New York, I feel, pushes you in a way. We're lucky, like, in the sense where there is a saying where in French we say marche ou crève. It's like, if you don't work, you will die. In New York, if you're not, like, trying to do different things and saying, oh, I opened something in Tokyo, oh, I opened in Paris, they're like, you disappear, because mm-hmm. competition is huge. Then you have to be always, like, doing something. It's true. And then when you tell them, oh, my God, I just opened this, they're like, wow. And then you get write-ups in the press. And it's very important, I think, as an entrepreneur. I also am, like, what we call a serial entrepreneur. I get bored if I don't do something.
I have here a little surprise for you that
really?
I did not tell you about. I have a list of names of all the celebrities, or a big portion of the celebrities that have worn your sunglasses and glasses over the years. So I'm just going to go through them. Yeah. Ryan Gosling, Lady Gaga, Kerry Hilson, Anne Hathaway, Rita Ora, Lenny Kravitz, Mary J. Blige, Amanda Seyfried, Jessica Hart, Will Ferrell, Maggie Gyllenhaal, Kate Moss, yeah. Christina Hendricks, Kate Beckinsale. Do you want me to go on? Or?
And you forgot Bono, because Bono was one of the first who put me on the map.
I just wanted to know, how does that make you feel?
I mean, the reality is, for me, everybody is the same. I'm not, like, starstruck, really. But I have to say that having those kind of clients has helped my business tremendously. Because when you have Bono wearing your glasses on a video, and he's, like, singing, and you see the glasses, then people go, especially now with the social media and, you know, the internet, people go immediately and say, whose glasses is he wearing? And Bono immediately resold out that production. Ryan Gosling has been also an amazing example for us. He did two movies, one called Drive, that was a huge success, and the other one, Crazy Stupid Love. And in both movies, he wears my glasses from the beginning to the end. And then the same, if you Google his name, Ryan Gosling glasses, my name appears. Then it helped me more in my business than, you know, making me feel happy, whatever. Even though some of them I really like, and some, you know.
I'm sorry, I missed one name that I should have mentioned that you told me a few days ago, Beyonce. So
yes,
I should say
yes.
Beyonce.
Also. And Jay-Z, yeah. Michael Jackson was a very good client. And what happened, we did a pair of glasses for his tour that was amazing, full of stones, incredible. But he didn't have a chance to wear them. He passed away just like a week before the tour.
I'd like to ask you to end this session by defining what success means to you.
Yeah, that's a tough question. Success for me is, you know, I would say being very happy and passionate about what you do, and not feeling, you know, like, let's say you work too much, but you don't feel like you're working too much because you're happy about what you're doing. Also, it's very important, success is being able to help others in different ways, by first employing them, but also by being involved in different charities. It's having a name like where when people can relate to your name and know that you're helping children, helping everything. That's what being able to give because you're successful is the most important, because when you give, it comes back to you.
Thank you very much, Selima Salaun.
Thank you.
Or should I say Dr. Selima Salaun?
Yes.
I'm opening up the floor for questions. Over here.
I'm sure there won't be that many questions than for chocolate.
I always hear that success comes through passion. So when did you got your passion for optics? When do you think you had that passion? When did it start? Because if your mom pushed you into it.
Yeah, my mom pushed me into it and I was angry, but I had no choice, like I said, because I wanted to be a vet. You know, when you have a dream and then your dream is like, no, forget about being a vet. You have to be an optician. And at one point I was like, okay, if I'm doing this, I have to do it the best I can. And then after I was like, I really wanted to impress my mother, I have to say, because my mother was for me somebody who was like, I was blown away by her. And being an Arab woman, being able to, and I felt always sad that she always spoke about like her dream being shattered when her father passed away. And I was like, it was strange. In a way, it was like a serendipity. It had to happen. And I wanted to make my parents proud, my family proud. And like Maribel, I have people in my family who work with me. And I'm really, I discovered a passion. When you do something, even if you don't like it in the beginning, but when you start doing it and you realize you're good at it, then that's how passion became, evident for me.
I'm just going to jump in here and ask you a question. I read on your website that you have a lot of pets. Is it three cats, two cats and three dogs?
Or four dogs and three cats.
Okay, there we go.
And yeah, I'm a huge animal lover. I love horses also, but I don't have horses in New York.
There are two questions in the back over there.
Hi.
Ahmed,
my name is Ahmed. How do you get inspired? Do you see something and get inspired with to do your designs for your glasses, or does it just come out at any time and you draw it and do a sketch? Or?
No, it's funny because what inspires me are people, and I love to travel, and actually now my next inspiration would be Bahrain. I have a lot of ideas. Members of Visionary gave me some ideas also about the pearls, making glasses with pearls, which I've never done, things like that. And it's watching people. I get inspired all the time, yeah.
Another question.
Hi.
Hi.
I have one question. If you have a time machine and you come back, go back with the time, would you be a vet or you continue with your professions now?
Ah. It's interesting. If there was a time machine, but if there was a time machine and I would know, if there was a time machine, I still would have no choice. My mother would be, you have to be an optician. But I have to say one thing. There's one thing that is really, for me, fascinating and interesting is the business sense, and creating a brand. And especially that's why as an Arab woman living in America, I will make a mark because like Khalifa said, I'm on the board of the CFDA, which is huge. We have Michael Kors, we have Diane von Furstenberg, Ralph Lauren, and I'm sitting with them. Selima Abdel Wahab, that's my maiden name. And I'm really, really proud as a woman first, because it's harder for women, I always say. I feel like we have to work much more. Mm-hmm. And as an Arab woman,
Right.
Yeah. Oh, thank you. Thank you.
I should add that Vera Wang is also on the board of the CFDA.
Yes, she is. We have a few... like very, very famous designers, Marc Jacobs,
And you're one of them.
Yeah.
Any other questions?
I always wonder, actually, when I'm sitting with them, I'm like, I can't believe I'm sitting here. You know, you have like the biggest, multi-billion companies, because you have to realize also, I'm maybe one of the only, and Maribel can attest to that, one of the only companies in America that is building a brand and that has absolutely no investors or anything, which is really rare, because it's hard, you know, to always go, you know, without the funds, you know.
Selima, thank you very much.
You're very welcome.
I'd like to go back to Coco and ask you one final question. What is your outlook for the future? And how do you see the future of creativity and talent in the coming decade?
I think the future, the most important thing to protect everything that human have achieved, like the internet, anything that we invented. But if we don't have peace, world peace, none of this music, art, fashion, chocolate, none of this would exist. So, so I think right now, number one priority for all of us is to have peace.
Yes.
And I just hope that all the big countries, you know, the big land, geographic, I forgot the word. But anyway, so I just think the world peace is most important, and you know, we have to do anything that we can to protect our earth, nature, the ocean, the mountain, the river, and the environment, to keep it clean for the children, for the generation, not just our country, but for other nations as well. So it's very important that each of us do whatever we can, either with music or with painting, chocolate, cooking, fashion, that we will focus on that, because thank you. And, yeah, so my outlook is we will try to have provide as much education and art to children around the world. And I think if we have good leaders, we all of us can work together, because certain country would have good rice, like Vietnam. I hopefully that we one day will be able to export to Bahrain. Sorry, but so we have Vietnam. Yes, thank you on the behalf of 90 million people. We thank you. Yeah, so 90 million people over 1,000 years, we're still, you know, in the rice field, and they start very early in the morning and they work very late at night. And so, like Vietnam, export rice and coffee, rubber, and again, we have very good weather, very good soil. It's not as hot as here. And every time I think about, Middle East, I just feel, wow, if I have a friend from Middle East, I always curious, like, how do you grow vegetable? So every time I grow washed vegetable, I'm keep thinking about my friends. So like, how do you do that? Because when the weather is very hot and then we see a lot of sands, and it's just the amount of, the sacrifice and difficulties of that is always, I'm very curious. And so, like, coming here, and so far it's very cool, and the country is so clean, and I see a lot of white is color of hope. And the white and the long outfit make me feel like I want to wear this today in honor of my grandmother. And I feel some like home a little bit, because in many years ago, thousands of years ago, we already wear very elegant outfit. And so I feel related. And so far it's been a dream, and very overwhelming. And I would like to thank you to Khalifa and Ali for giving us this opportunity in the beginning. So nervous. I didn't even, yeah. So it's really, I hope that this trip is not the last trip. And I would, I was telling Khalifa that I would love to have the relationship between Bahrain and Vietnam to have the consular, even just two officers in Hanoi. We would love to see and welcome you so we can learn about the culture.
We were talking earlier today, and you mentioned that the Arabic letters were like musical notes to you.
Yeah, that's what I noticed. The first thing when I received the invitation from the cultural minister, our minister of culture, I said, I'm looking at music notes. I should put this invitation on the piano and play it to see what happened. But it's really basically it's note. All the note, because I use the pen, you know, from English pen, and when you write like this, the note, and it does look like very graphic. So I just feel that, you know, like in all the sign on the street, I'm like, I feel music, I hear music. So it's really, yeah, I fall in love with the letter. I think it's very beautiful.
Could you tell us quickly what upcoming events and concerts do you have planned that you'd like to share with us?
We have the next event is in Monaco again, will be the third time. Last year we had the Oceanographic Museum and the Naval Museum. The first time was at the Chapital, the capital, the principality of Monaco. And this year, we were talking about Khalifa, because I saw the museum, and I'm friends with the director of the Oceanographic Museum, and I said, what can we do with Bahrain? So we were talking to some friends, and I was doing some studying, and I said that there is something very interesting about the culture here is a diving pearl with their, you know, right? Yeah. So I talked to them and they said, actually, it's very interesting. We would love to see the old photograph and have the exhibition. So anyway, the next one is September 18. Would love to invite as many of you as possible. We'll send the official invitation to Khalifa. And then maybe we set up the meeting. And
of course. I should mention that your most recent concert will be this coming Monday, which is after tomorrow, here at the Cultural Hall. And we're going to give you more details about that at the end of this event. Lieberman, what is your outlook for the future as an artist and as a chef and as a designer and as a businesswoman?
Oh my God. I don't know. You know what? My brand, I started with my flavors, and because I always think of the flavors of the world, and I want to see my brand everywhere, actually, because I like to create things, because cultures is what attracted me to create my brand. You know, the flavors in my chocolate, you're going to find familiar. And I feel that it's just a composition to for you to become familiar with other cultures.
Right. And do you have any upcoming events or what's on your calendar for the next couple of months?
Right now we just opened actually two boutiques in Japan. We have four all together, and I'm very happy to say that we have lines waiting to come into the store, so I'm very happy. We make everything in New York, and we export. And I hope one day I can make it for here.
Dr. Selima, what is your outlook for the future?
Yeah, like Coco, I would say also world peace, and being able by having also an international brand. You know, like promoting my brand and having go traveling the world and provide jobs. Yeah, yeah, very important. As much as possible, of course. Thank you. Provide jobs as much as possible.
Thank
Thank you all very much.
The next event, we're talking about having mission visionaries to do an event at Carnegie Hall to celebrate Bahrain culture with classical music, and we would love to have like something very traditional from Bahrain in New York, and because we have a lot of good friends and supporters and in a good society in New York, I think it will be very exciting.
Yeah.
Don't you think?
Yes, very good idea.
Yeah? So we can plan it, I would say in hopefully in 4, 5, or 6 months, I would say, you know, we can have that. And I think that'll be exciting.
Thank you all very much. I'd like to just conclude with do you have a question? Okay, yeah. Do we have a microphone?
Thank you. My name is Dr. Hada. First of all, welcome home and thank you for your presentation. I think you agree with me, I mean the audience, maybe that we have an excellent or interesting presentation from your side. But definitely all of us today, before we leave, because I know exactly the preparation being done before this session, I think we all of us agree that the juniors and the team needs a big thank from us because they did a great job. And this is what we are proud in Bahrain about this generation of how they organized the whole thing from, you name it, from Khalifa and to Amr. So thank you very much, and you really deserve a big thank you from all of us here.
Hi, I'm Sahamata. This has been very, very fascinating. Thank you very, very much. And I know you've spoken about the future and your plans, but I was wondering if I could just take you back to one point. Each one of you must have, and this is a question for the three of you really, each one of you must have come to a point in your journey where you felt that hopeless, or you didn't know what to do next. Can you possibly describe that and then talk about what made you move on? Because every entrepreneur must have that difficulty at some point.
But I think it's part of the journey. You will go through failure, I've done so many mistakes. I lost so much money. And I'm like, oh my God, I should stop. Am I stupid or what? But then that's part of who you are. You are like a serial entrepreneur, and you will always go ahead. And that's the key to success, actually. Like when you don't take the failure as a failure. It's like Churchill was saying that also. It's part of
learning.
Yes, exactly. You will definitely feel hopeless. You will definitely think, I have to stop this. You will definitely fail and make mistakes, but it's part of it, you know.
So I think the key is to always do a lot of things at the same time. So like if you cannot get in from the front door, you get in from the kitchen door. If it's not from the window. If it doesn't work, you get in from the chimney. And you just keep dreaming very big. You have a set of a big dream, because one thing about America is they said, I learned from in Orlando, dream it and you will make it. Yes. So if you have a dream, and you know exactly what your dream is, then you go out light and you pick friends from all walks of life, and if you already have that dream, then the people that you pick, it's almost like, okay, I know what dish I'm gonna cook, so I'm gonna know exactly what vegetable or what meat or what fish I'm gonna buy to make that dish. So first we sit down and we meditate and we pray, whatever, and then we have a dream and believe in yourself and accept that it will fail. But luckily for artists, whenever we fail, we get very excited because that is our inspire. That is our, you know, energy to create things. Even like when you're heartbroken or you sad, and you take advantage of that emotion to create something that will make people feel related, and that is, I think that's the reason that we're not too afraid of failure.
And I think also being spiritual helps a lot, you know, thanking for what you have, and you know, it helps me a lot when I feel hopeless. I'm like, you know, I talk to God and I say,
Vietnamese, you know, we talk about that all the time.
But also, as Vietnamese, we live, we have like thousands of proverbs of wisdom over a thousand years. So it, as a little child, remember from all the neighbors and everybody saying. And it's important thing is to be loyal. So with being loyal, sometimes it's really, you never have to worry too much about the future. Because being loyal to even the little people or not important people at all, sometimes bring into a very big journey and important journey.
Thank you, Coco. Thank you,
Maribel.
Thank you.
One thing I just want to say that there's always solutions. Always, the only one that we can solve is going down. So, but there's always solutions.
I'd like to invite you all to explore the mini exhibition we have set up here. There are several of Coco's famous paintings, a large display of Maribel's chocolates and Selima's sunglasses. I'd also like to remind you of Coco's performance this coming Monday, the day after tomorrow, at 8 p.m. at the Cultural Hall right next to the Bahrain National Museum. We hope to see you all there, and thank you for attending today. Thank you very much.